Blender 4.0 is out, and I have been waiting with bated breath for some of these updates for literal years. Now, I've used Maya, 3D Max, and Blender all long term. I didn't just dabble, so we've gotten to know each other pretty damn well over the years. So rest assured, this video is coming from a place of knowledge of other 3D packages.
So these are the changes I'm most excited about. Let's start with light linking, which I already briefly mentioned. Light linking allows you to specify exactly which objects a light will affect, and shadow linking determines which objects cast shadows. It's super easy to use as well. You just assign a collection for a specific light to influence in the light's object properties, and you drag and drop objects or collections into it from the outliner.
In terms of animation, if we're being completely honest with ourselves, and yes, I'm talking to you, Blender evangelicals, Blender has not really been able to compete with Maya in terms of the animation tools. But it's definitely starting to get there, especially with these latest updates to the graph editor. Maybe the most notable update has been when you have really dense keys in your graph editor, you know what I'm talking about, Blender would often crash or get really, really slow. But now the performance has been improved by up to 5 to 10 times, depending on the zoom level. The animation playback timing has also been improved to avoid jitter between frames.
They also have these new click and slide operations. You can easily blend selected keys into an ease in or ease out, move selected keyframes all together so the first and last keys align with the keys before and after your selection, shear the keys based on the position of the last keyframe selection, scale selected keys by their average on the y-axis, increase or decrease the value of selected keys by just clicking and sliding, and shift the value of selected keys in time. Butterworth smoothing keeps the overall shape of the curve but minimizes smaller fluctuations, basically smoothing everything out for you. This is all going to make our animation lives way easier. Another pretty cool thing they've added is that the 3D view now has a new region in your viewport called the Asset Shelf, which allows you to access your asset library without opening a separate editor. So far, it only works for pose assets, and you need to make sure you have the pose library add-on enabled. Just go over to the animation tab here when you're in pose mode and toggle the Asset Shelf. They've also made updates to the NLA editor, where strips can now be vertically reordered. You can drag them through existing strips and locked tracks, and it vertically clamps scrolling to the view to stop that pesky infinite scrolling.
Bone layers have been replaced by bone collections. We could use collections for objects since Blender 2.8, but not for bones. Until now.
We no longer have to mess around with the super lame layers that we previously had to work with. You know what I'm talking about. It's not like we were able to name these layers, oh no. We'd be going through each one, switching it on and off, trying to find which one contained the controls on the bones we'd be looking for. But now, we can place bones into collections and actually name them, and you're not limited to having only 32 layers anymore.
They've also improved the snapping, which I am so super happy about because it could be quite a headache previously. If you know, you know.
While transforming, you can set a snap base. So grab your object with G, then set the snap base using the B key, so you set which part you want to snap, and you can snap to vertices, edges, whatever. And look how easy that was, mother trucker! Whereas before it was pretty touch and go whether you'd actually get the part you wanted to snap to whatever else you wanted it to snap to, it's much easier to work with now. It also works in edit mode the same way.
You can also now save incrementally. Finally! So when you're saving, you either hit Ctrl+Alt+S or Save Incremental, and it'll save a new version of your file incremented by one. Now, I don't know about you guys, but I used to hate the color picker. It was such a drag that you had to go out of your file and try and find the hex values or the RGB values of whatever color you wanted to use in Blender. You couldn't just color pick outside the window. Well, guess what, guys? Now you can. The default color transform, which previously was filmic, they still have it there as an option, has now been changed to AGX.
Which gives us better color accuracy and handles bright lights and their saturation more accurately. So that means you'll get more realistic and accurate colors in bright and overexposed areas. AGX has more nuance and preserves the colors better, and the brights go towards white, like with real cameras. The modifier view has also had an overhaul, and while I panicked a little at first because I've gotten so used to the previous layout, it is a lot more compact now and maybe less overwhelming to new users. Speaking of UI changes, all add menus can now be searched instantly by typing, and this will definitely speed up your workflow. Nodes can now have collapsible sections, which makes the shaders with lots of layers, like the principal BSDF shader, much more manageable to work with.
The anisotropic shader has now been scrapped, and the effect is now an option on the glossy shader. And the velvet BSDF has been renamed to the sheen BSDF, and is a much more natural and realistic result in cycles.
Sheen in the principal BSDF better simulates fabric and works for dust as well now by using a new microfiber shading model which sits on top of all the layers. There have been other awesome updates to the BSDF shader too, making it generally much more physically accurate. The IOR, or index of refraction value, is used throughout the shader, and the old specular slider is now adjusted with the IOR level, which acts as a reflectivity multiplier. They've also improved SSS for skin, with an IOR input attached which makes it behave more realistically. This is only available for the skin random walk, and it now uses the base color as an input instead of three separate colors. There are new inputs for the noise texture and the Voronoi node, and they support a higher level of detail. The Voronoi texture node now has inputs for detail, roughness, and lacunarity, and they've also added a normalized property, which remaps the distance and color outputs to a 0 to 1.0 range. Also, glossy shaders in cycles now support path guiding, where previously it was only supported for diffuse shaders, so this should make for cleaner renders with less noise. Normal maps have also had an update, thank goodness, because they used to be kind of annoying and finicky, but now the strength can be pushed past a value of 1 without the lower values going negative and causing weird behaviors and artifacts, like those black spots you would sometimes get. For geometry nodes, we now have node tools. So nodes can be run as regular operators, which is good news for people who don't know Python. You can create your own tools and modifiers, which is crazy. Over here, I just created a voxel modifier. Obviously, you can make cooler stuff. This was just me trying it out. But once you've marked it as an asset, it shows up as a modifier and you can apply it to your objects. So once you've got your geometry node set up, just make it a modifier. So it's super easy to use and reuse for repetitive operations.
So these updates may not feel like a major overhaul, but they are definitely going to make our lives a lot easier as 3D artists and animators. There is obviously a bunch of other stuff that I just didn't have time to go through in this video, but if you want to know more about them, just check it out in the release notes. Thank you to my patrons over on Patreon, as always, for all the support. I greatly appreciate it. If you liked the video, hit the like button. Subscribe if you want to keep up to date with my other videos. Thanks for watching. Hope it was helpful. Bye!